So everyone who just joining, I just want to say that I haven't dived into the main topic. I'm just going through the process of general announcements. This stuff will be available as a playback, so you can play it anytime. All this introduction stuff, after the stream is over, it is automatically created, and I'll be sending the relevant links out as well. But I think the link will be the same, so we're good there. All right. So going back to the exercise book. So like I was saying, we built enough FAT to be able to go and be able to talk about to do various practices. So this is when the exercise book comes handy, and part of the exercise book that comes handy is the table of topics. So on the screen you can see the table of topics that are broken down by Code of Federal Regulations. They are broken down by the section, and further on we also see them being broken down by the free trade agreements. We have them broken down by the HTSUS chapter numbers, general rules of interpretation, which we'll be covering today, and they are also broken down by U.S. code and forums. So the main and I'm in the process of changing that table of topics as during this class. So I think I reached the climax for the textbook. So what I'm doing is I'm going to break it down into the more section sensitive assignments. But for now, what you can see is within the textbook itself. So for example, remember last class we were talking about the general provisions, and part of general provisions, which involves part 101 of the CFR, also involved a little bit about question 400, I'm sorry, section 7.2. I think it dealt with insular possessions of the United States. So the way I would suggest for you to practice, so we have question 432, which is responsive to section 7.2. So what you do is you go to the to that question. So in this case, it would be 432 over here on page, let me see, 208 of the textbook. So once you get to the page, you see this question 432, and it poses a question for you guys from the previous customs license broker exam. When merchandise is imported into the United States or Virgin Island, which laws govern the importation? And that is responsive to that section 7.2 of the general provisions. And of course, from those who attended the last week's class, they know that it is U.S. Virgin Island law, because it is not customs territory of the United States. And if you want to check yourself, you jump to page 702. And on page 702, we have the rationale. And we have the correct answer. So that's pretty much the way the book is helpful is you can check yourself on the questions which are pertinent to the particular topic. And as you recall, from the textbook, and I'm talking about the textbook, it's this textbook, when we discuss the chapters, each chapter is broken down into the relevant topics, which have assigned provision of the Code of Federal Regulations so far, or the HTSUS. So So those provisions you can refer back later, and as you compile. By the way, all of you should be either in process or already have ordered the HTS-US and the CFR. If you haven't, or you have a problem doing that, Mike, thank you. Mike is helping me out in the background to do my IT stuff. Okay, thank you, Mike. This textbook should be used as a way to check yourself on the knowledge you gain from a particular chapter. And what we're going to do is we're going to dive into the world of harmonized tariff schedule of the United States. So, with respect to the HTS-US, we have, and I'll be using the January 20th edition, but as I'm going to jump back and forth because I'll be using the sample questions, I think I'm hoping to get to some sample questions. Of course, we have to build a platform before we do that. So, I'm going to sometimes be using the USITC online database, which is more modern. But the question, at least the questions that I will be touching upon, they will not be changed a lot by all this scenario. So, by going back to the first class. I have asked you by virtue of providing the outline to start memorizing and associating the harmonized tariff schedule chapter name to the chapter number. And I did ask you to also kind of understand the structure of the HTS as far as general notes are concerned. I believe this would be the chart for the general notes, chart 3 of the first outline, introduction outline for the memory purposes. So we did start some kind of feel, if you will, for the HTS-US itself. The current HTS-US, as we can see, it's almost 4,000 pages long. Do you or will you have will you know all what's on all of those 4,000 pages? Of course not. But the idea here is number one is to be a good librarian, to know the structure, to know how it is composed, and this is something which we're going to try to take a stab at today. So, of course, the starting point for the HTS-US is the preamble. The preamble says that there is this government body, it's called the US International Trade Commission, and it is the one in charge for the US for administration of customs for administration of the HTS-US. And if I may, what I want to do is I want to bring it up on the screen, usitc.gov. Let me see if I can do that. Yep, it's right there. So we do have that usitc, and the link to the code is provided on the Law Customs website, and I'll be going to that often simply because I have a short list of questions which I like. So, what I have the list of short links in the bottom of the website, and it is HTS-US online reference tool. That's the one I'm talking about again. Maintained by the US International Trade Commission. Now, why are we looking for primarily why we're looking at the preamble. It's just general stuff, right? Well, it so happens that customs examiners, they do test on this stuff. So I used to kind of skip it in the passing, but I think it's generally a good practice to be able to set the stuff that are being tested in the context of history. And in this case, we're talking about the legal history of how it all started. So we do have this body. It's called World Customs Organization. This is a body that is responsible or in charge of kind of overseeing this very harmonized harmonized tariff system. It wasn't around all the time. If you look at the history, you can see it. Its roots date back to the Customs Cooperation Council, and we're talking about the 1947 post-war World War II Europe. Some of you may recall that we touched a little bit on this last time when we discussed the the global economic order. So outside the Eastern Bloc and the countries of the former Soviet Union, which had which implemented socialist system, we had market economies, economic countries, and there were a lot of disagreements, especially between the United States and Great Britain. The major problem with Great Britain was that it used to be a superpower, but as a result of the World War II, it was no longer able to maintain its status. But United States was. And of course, United States had its own, at least at the administration level, which was sent for negotiations between, for example, Bretton Woods. And in Bretton Woods, you had clash of economists. So you had one economist, I believe it was Keynes himself, John Maynard Keynes. He was arguing for this international currency, which would be implemented, but the United States, of course, wanted the dollar to be the international currency, not some currency which is managed by the international by the international body, such as United Nations, for example, or the IMF. So there were clashes, and of course we know that as a matter of history, that United States pretty much had its way, but that wasn't without problems. So going back to the history. So in 1947, this is this dialogue which paved its way later to the system of harmonized tariff schedule, and the World Customs Organization has started. So the convention itself was signed into the in 1950. Right, but by back then it was only 17 parties which were part of it. Here is the old photograph of the deliberations taking place. Then 1947, you do have the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, and it didn't create the World Customs Organization per se, but the idea of harmonization of trade was going hand in hand with General Agreements on Tariff and Trade. And of course, we know in 1994 it became the World Trade Organization, But at the same at that time, there was a general move toward harmonization of the tariffs and a lowering of the trade barriers. And there is a reason for that as well. You can see that if you trace your those of you that are history buffs, of course, please correct me if I'm wrong, but during the 19th century, or even going back to the 18th century, at the height of the British Empire, the British did insert external barriers, which encouraged the trade within it between the Great Britain and its colonies. And to outsiders, it was virtually non-penetrated. They could not penetrate because of the high tariff barriers and other protections. And that was very beneficial because Britain, I believe, at the height controlled more than a quarter of the world trade. So United States comes around, and to every hegemon, it is very much beneficial to lower the trade barriers. So the simply because it dictates the rules, right? So in case of the United States, it's pretty much continued the game that Great Britain started in 18th and 19th centuries. So it continued this game well into the 20th century, but at the global scale. Well, of course, we're taking the Soviet bloc countries and Warsaw Convention countries outside, but even then, after the fall of the Soviet Union in 1991, 1992, they also were kind of consumed by this global trade. So, United States looked very favorably at such institutions as general agreement of tariffs and trade. It looked very favorably on World Customs Organization, and by 1950, let me see. So 1950, you have the creation of that convention. 1953, you have inauguration. Those 17 European members are there, and 1994. We're talking about the World Customs Organization adopting the name as it is, and of course, 1994 is also the day the World Trade Organization, or WTO, were created. So if you look at the global world, which we have today. We do have we have much of the world, pretty much, which is the member of the World Customs Organization. And what does it mean? That simply means the following. So, let me pull up the HTSUS, and I'll be using the HTSUS chapter 39 as an example. So let's go to what I like to call the constitution of the harmonized tariff schedule, and we're talking about the general rules of interpretation. So this is like the Constitution of the United States, because it's written so broadly and it can be applied in so many ways that it's very frustrating sometimes to apply it, but at the same time you can find a comfort in making sense out of it, because you are being you're being always guided at that general level of provisions. So the HTSUS system itself, that 4,000 pages worth of text that you guys got or about to get, they pertain to they designed to cover almost every product there is, and of course every product there is in the world, and of course there are issues with that because it's kind of hard to cover everything, and how you cover everything, this is sort of an enormous task, if you will. And on top of that, new stuff are coming out all the time. I remember there was so much commotion with the LED lights, because LED lights, for example, used to be a new technology. Back then we had incandescent lights, we had the light bulbs. We had other light bulbs. The LED stuff, we had infrared, for example. We had those discharge gas lamps, but the LED were new technology and they were not designed to be part of the HTSUS system. And if this is something new, and of course HTSUS, or the harmonized portion of it, is always playing a catch-up to what's going on. You do have to design the text in flexible enough way to be able to accept new stuff that are coming out as a part of the progress of our society. We have also to be able to accommodate the old stuff, and whatever is not specifically specified or specifically prescribed within the text, we need to have some kind of rules to be able to accept this stuff. And on top of that, we also must be flexible enough to adjust these rules for particular policies of the country. Hence, you have those general notes, the free trade agreements, all that stuff, that are able to guide you throughout your application and determination of the harmonized tariff schedule. So, going to the chapter, let's stick at the chapter 39, plastic. So you have toilet seats, let's say, right, or the shower baths, right, sinks and wash basins, right, made out of plastics. So this very thing alone allows you to determine so the determination itself allows you to really jump to several conclusions. So number one, this thing allows you to determine the duty. That's number one. Number two, it allows you to determine the quantity units, and determine any report, because the duty itself, sometimes it is done as the percentages we see here. Sometimes it is done as a weight, based on weight. So percentages are usually called ad valorem. The weights is usually called specific rate of duty. And we also have combination. So we can have the percentage plus the specific rate of duty, based on either weight or number.